Hi, and welcome to my talk. This is Abram Hindle from the Department of Computing Science at the University of Alberta. This is a talk aimed at the Compute 301 course. This talk is on test-driven development. So, we have automated testing. The purpose of automated testing is basically to help us test and write software. Automated testing provides us with feedback about if our software is working according to our specifications or not. It's limited in the sense that you still need manual testing to observe certain problems. Unless you have really great test suites that are domain dependent, it's hard to test for things like strange noises from speakers or flickering graphics. They might require a lot of tooling in order to actually observe those issues. The reason we want to write good unit tests is because they explain how our system will work, and actually it documents our code. So a good unit test is simple to write and understand. Understand is important because it communicates to other developers how this is supposed to be used. Furthermore, by keeping it simple, we reduce the chance of defects in code. This means they should also be small, because the more lines of code we get, the more defects we tend to get. Furthermore, a good unit test should run quickly, because we want to rerun these unit tests over and over and over again. We want to give ourselves feedback as quickly as possible, because that will give us the courage to make changes, and we'll be able to see feedback in terms of the results that we get. Unit tests should be isolated. This means that one unit test should not depend on another. The setup of one unit test should not be dependent on another unit test. If unit tests are completely independent of each other and will not manipulate each other, then we can write multiple unit tests in parallel. And parallelism enables us to actually run quickly and faster, because most of the computers we have nowadays are multiple CPUs. Also, it allows us to run across multiple machines too, which means that we can reduce our test time, especially if our tests take a long time. A good automated unit test will show exactly what went wrong when it fails. You should really consider that unit tests should be basically like what the debugger will tell you, except this runs many times. You should consider using unit tests over the debugger, because what happens is when you write a unit test, you keep that code. That unit test can be run again and again and again. It's like running the debugger many, many times, and you save that manual effort. But if the unit test communicates what's wrong, it'll be easier to fix later. The issues will be easier to fix. Martin Fowler says this about automated testing. Whenever you are tempted to type something into a print statement or a debugger expression, write it as a test instead. So if you want to jam printf in code, or if you want to run the debugger, you should consider whether or not you should just write a unit test instead. The nice thing about the unit test is you keep it around. So here is from The Way of Testivus by Alberto Savoia. So think of code and tests as one. When writing the code, think of the tests. When writing the tests, think of the code. When you think of code and tests as one, testing is easy and the code is beautiful. So what Alberto is trying to get across is that when you write code, think about how to test it. When you're writing tests, think about the code that should implement these tests. It's also suggesting that maybe when you write the tests, you should think about the code you want to write. So you can write tests, say, first, and define the API you want to use, right? Because it's one, and then you implement it. And then when you implement it, you're referencing your tests. So he's not necessarily saying one first over the other. He's saying if they're written almost as one, if they're not all that distinct, you're going to make testable code, and you're going to make code that is pretty, that is beautiful, code that is the code that you want to use, because you didn't want to write a complicated test to test bad code. You wanted to write a simple test to test good code. So that kind of motivation means you maybe are going to write better code because you wrote the test for it first that defines the interface that you want to use, and you want to usually keep that interface small and simple. The way of Testivus goes on to say, the best time to test is when the code is fresh. Your code is like clay. When it is fresh, it's soft and malleable. As it ages, it becomes hard and brittle. If you write tests when code is fresh and easy to change, testing will be easy, and both the code and the test will be strong. You, as a human being, have limited long-term, short-term, and medium-term memory. When it is fresh in your mind, you understand the code. It is a good time to test it because you understand the limitations of the code or what the code is supposed to do. Furthermore, when the code is fresh, other bits of code do not rely on it as much. It doesn't become a written-in-stone API. It's not necessarily what is required for the system yet. When the code ages, it means you probably need that code and it's being used over time. Furthermore, it will gain dependencies. These dependencies might, whether they be client code or code that it relies upon, will limit its evolution, but also due to this limited API that it will now inherit, it's harder to actually test. So basically, he's saying if you write the tests early and you write the code with the tests will be better representative of the code and you'll generally get something better quality, whereas if you write tests after the fact, you have very little choice in the API. And you can't change things. You can only really just test them. And then your tests might be really complicated as well. And if your tests were really complicated, you'd probably notice that they were becoming complicated. So it's better if they're written at the same time so you can change the code before it becomes hard and brittle. So all of this is related to test-driven development. Test-driven development is written around the idea of, if testing is so useful, let's write the tests first. Essentially, these automated tests are meant to capture code-level requirements that are meant to be satisfied. You design the API that you want, the API that you want to see. Okay? So once the code is written so that these tests pass, the requirements are considered to be met. This means that you write tests and you write them in the style of the code that you want to see, not the code that you expect to get. This means that when you code it, you write code that meets these tests, so you don't have to deal with that kind of scenario. So here's traditional development. First, you write a method interface. Then you write the method body. Then you write the automated test. You run the automated test. You adjust the method and retest that until the test passes. All right? So you write it first. You write the test. You run. You repeat adjusting the method and retest until your tests pass. With test first or test-driven development, you first write your automated test, you run the automated test, you find out it doesn't work, it fails. Then you write the method interface and stubs. This means you provide the structure and then you provide empty method calls that you can call, and then you run the test again. If the tests pass at this point, it means that you're not testing any functionality because fundamentally you've written structure, not code. So what you should go and do is write the method bodies and run the tests again. If your tests passed, you should write better tests. You should actually test for functionality. Once you've augmented the tests and once you've written the test method bodies, you should run the automated tests again. And then you should repeat until your tests finally pass. So adjust and then repeat. All right, so test-driven development. You write automated tests first. In traditional development, you write the code first. In test-driven development, you run the automated tests before you have code. In traditional development, you run automated tests once you've written the automated tests, but after the code exists. In test-driven development, you use empty methods, stubs, and interfaces to basically provide the structure that you're going to rely upon. So now I want to get into the JUnit framework. because you're going to use it in class. So for JUnit, you generally have a structure like this. You've got a test, it's got test cases, and it's got a test suite. A test suite is an aggregation of tests. A test case is basically a set of tests that you can run. Okay? But test cases are tests. And test suites are composed of tests. What you can do is you can have a hierarchy where you have test suites that are composed of test suites or test cases. And then you can run all of these test suites and test cases by running the highest level test suite that you have. Each of your tests should be named the name of your class. So imagine you have a class named Foo, and then they should have tests at the end. So if you have Foo, you should have Foo test. And Foo test should be a subclass of test case. So here we want to make a test case. It's the implementation. We want to make a test case. We want to make it for Foo, and we call that Foo test. The test case should be in the same package as Foo. Why should it be in the same package? So that it can access non-public members of Foo. Then, to write test methods, you add these test methods to the Foo test class. What should happen is these test methods should implement one or more test cases that are meant to be checked. You should probably keep the test methods small and simple, because your JUnit framework will usually monitor how many tests you got. The Foo test class, which is a test case, the Foo test class will test the object, and it might test objects that will be used in many test methods. Sometimes it's expensive to set up the object, so making a setup method to initialize the objects or fixtures before each test method is run is recommended. So if you need to, say, make a database connection, in setup might be a good idea. Then in the teardown, once you're done running the tests, you can get rid of that database connection or any other stuff that you need to get rid of. You might have to close files, you might have to delete files, you might have to do a bunch of work. When you want to write a test, you add it to Foo test. It'll be public void test something. So if you wanted to test the feature bar of Foo test, you might write public void test bar. And then you would have code inside of it where you might actually test the functionality more. So inside of the test, you might initialize more specific test objects. You might test specific methods, and in the test case, in that method test bar, you might verify that bar runs and bar meets what you want by using assertion statements. So let's start off. Here is public class number test. It extends test case because it's part of JUnit. We're going to have a number and another number. In our setup, we're going to assign number to 2 and another number to 3. We've got one test here. It's called test equals. First off, it checks to see if a number equals null. So if a number equals null, then that's bad. We don't want that. So we make sure that's never equal to null. The next one is assert equals. It checks to see if a number equals a number. The next one checks to see if a number equals a new number. This means that we're really checking to see if it's doing references, if it's going equal equal, or if it's calling the dot equals method. Technically, a number should return true, that a new number 2 dot equals a new number 2. Then we also check to see if a number doesn't equal not a number, or another number. So does 2 equal 3? No. more example test code, we can have test add. This is another test case. So we had test equals, now we have test add. We can make an expected number, and then we can add it, add to it, and then we can compare it against an expected result. So a number and another number are 2 and 3. So 2 plus 3 should be 5. So therefore, number 5 should equal the result of 2 plus 3. If you want more information, go check out the JUnit documentation. Okay? So, to review, your test cases, right? Test case is an aggregation of smaller test cases that are methods. You have to make a class. You call it your class test and extends test case. You can have a setup and a teardown. Your tests are simply public void methods that are called test and then some string afterwards. So this is slightly confusing. What JUnit will do is it will say, oh, you are a test case class, right? You're a test case class. So give me all of your methods that start with test. Then for all of your methods that start with the word test, let's run them as test cases. And that's what JUnit does. It inspects the test case class that you made and looks for test methods to run. And does this via Java reflection. So consider this functional code. We've got public class number, it's got a private int value, we've got equals, and we check to see if it's a number, and if it's not a number, and if it's not an instance of number, we return false. So you should consider what method should be tested with JUnit. You should usually write tests for things that have side effects. Writing tests for every getter and setter is usually a waste of time. You can use assertions on the outputs of the getter methods to check that the constructor and setter methods work properly, but usually the stuff you should focus on is the stuff that does complicated things that has side effects. That means it mutates state. It's not just getting. So the JUnit framework is slightly more complicated than just tests and test cases. There's the composite pattern here of tests, and basically a test case is a command. It's a command pattern. It uses a template method, and it runs things, and it's got test results. So what happens is, when you go run, right, it will basically run all your tests and aggregate all the test result in the test result. And this test result will be used to report back to JUnit what was going on and what test passed, what test failed. So JUnit is relatively complicated, but at the very least, you can get your Java tests run. Now, some resources you can rely upon. Kent Beck wrote Test-Driven Development. That's a pretty worthwhile book. There's also Testing Computer Software, Lessons Learned in Software Testing. We've also got links regarding the cause of the AT&T network failure, which is sort of current since I think Rogers Network recently had a network failure. The Way of Testivus, JUnit, flexible design, testable design, you don't have to choose. Basically, if you do test first, it's not a big deal. All right, thank you for your time.